I'm just going to introduce Professor Van der Zwaan. He's going to give us lecture on vascular anastomosis. I think nothing captures the imagination of residents than vascular anastomosis. And Professor Van der Zwaan is from Utrecht.
Thanks,
if anyone knows anything about history of anastomosis, you will know that Utrecht had a very prominent role with Professor Tulikinen. And Professor Van der Zwaan has taken over his practice. And I was privileged to see Professor Tulikinen's talks, and certainly it was one of those highlights. So Professor Van der Zwaan is going to give us talks on anastomosis. Most of us wouldn't probably be doing it, but we will be better for knowing it, and certainly it inspires neurosurgery residents like nothing. And having a knowledge of and understanding of it, it actually makes you feel that you know a rounded idea of vascular neurosurgery. Thank you, Professor Van der Zwaan.
Thank you very much for your introduction. I will stay in my time just for one thing before for lunch. I'll try that. But before I can show you my presentation, I want to really express that it's very, very important that it's on a double, but it's a double production. But it's very important that, and that's the main issue, I think, is that we need vascular neurosurgeons in this area of endovascular treatments, perfect treatments, absolutely great. But the cases that we have to treat are getting more and more complicated because we get the more difficult cases. So that's why we need vascular neurosurgeons. And it's not when you go to the ESMINS. Hopefully we'll meet you again in the ESMINT in September, and also in the vascular section of the ANS meeting. You're also very much invited. It's so much often heard, oh, we don't need those vascular neurosurgeons, but we do here. Need them. And I'll show you the case. First, I have two hobbies. First is my saxophone, and second is my vessels. And talk about principles of vascular anastomosis. It's just nothing more than communication between two vessels. That's an anastomosis, if you go to the beginning. And if you go to the beginning, you really need to know that before you have a vessel, you have angioblasts. And in the vasculogenesis, that's where the vessel is formed. In this whole procedure, you finally get into the major vessels. And then you get to a plexity, or what we call a rete. It's what we call a rete because it's nothing but a plexus of vessels. And out of that, maturation and adaptation starts, and then we get that vessel. And you see it on the right side in the same scheme. And this way of seeing two vessels and seeing the anastomosis in that way, also in development, you see that there's this rete mirabilis that is so often talked about in animals. And the main important thing of rete mirabilis is heat control, but it's also a pressure control for the brain. Think of woodpeckers, think of giraffes. That's one thing. So it's already an adaptation of vessels by anastomosis. And you see another example like here. So this is the very natural way when we look at vessels. You see that's the capillary arteries, but you also have these natural arteriovenous anastomosis with sphincters before it and after that. And these are especially pictures out of the research done for vessels in heart and in skin. And you see there's the vasculogenesis, that's the blasts, and then you have the arteriogenesis, and that becomes vessels grow because of increased shear stress. I won't go into much into the deep to that. But it's also the angiogenesis out of hypoxia. But all, that's how it is stated, pre-existing arterioles. And that is something that we have to discuss about, because that's not completely true. Because these factors that have influence on these vasculogenesis are studied in laboratories where we know they have these factors. But we also know from practice that there are also newly formed arteries. From extracranial, intercranial. Think of those burr holes that we sometimes make to make some anastomosis from outside, inside. That's new vessels. So that's not pre-existing vessels. And we know this is a very commonly known thing, and that we know that when we are in distress, we can open sphincters and close sphincters so that we can regulate the perfusion of the vessels and the perfusion of the tissue. To remind you, these arteries, this is again to the of the skin, but we don't know exactly if these sphincters are really there in the brain. That's still a point of discussion. But we know that in distress, if there's stenosis, new arteries, or on long term, newly formed arteries can grow in the leg, as you see in this example. But you also are very known with the circle of Willis, this very clever adapted system of, well, actually, it's coming out of the rete mirabilis of the man. And we see now in the very old literature that this is the distribution of the vascular territories. And I show you this picture because I want to go to what I'd done several, long time ago. I did 3 years of research on vascular territories in the laboratory. And I learned so much of that. This is this experiment I did at that time. It has never been repeated since then because it's very difficult. You can do these experiments in fresh brains only. That's some practical. You see that they will push, mimic the arterial pressure system in these territories. And then you can see and this investigate the territories of the vascular, the territories of the vascular territories in the brain. And you see that example like this, different colors. And you see you can go into the capillaries. It's all very nice, looks great. And these are these anastomosis, natural anastomosis. Collaterals between red and green can be anterior, posterior cerebral arteries or middle cerebral arteries. Here again, so they are there. We know that, but we don't know how they are there, and we don't know how variable what the variability is of these vessels. I'll come up to that later. Well, in the past there was so much discussion in the anatomy world. Do we have collaterals? Are they functional or not? You see, it's like a wave in history. But now, we know more and more about that, and we know that they are important, can be important, let's say like that. And this is an example of an experiment that goes wrong. And that's what we call serendipity, because you can learn from experiments that go wrong. You see if the pressure here on this side of the anterior cerebral artery, pressure on the middle cerebral artery, but then one of these catheters got loose. At nothing, then a pressure drop in one of these arteries. And then you see that this territory, this red territory, is taken over by collaterals. You see them coming out. This is this experimental collateral function you can see. So after that, we thought, hey, maybe we could measure that. So having this, and we know that in the distal part, there's no filling of the capillaries anymore. You can make that. And this is a kind of artificial blood we make. And then you measure that you just do the pressure drop here, and you see that there will the vascular territory will be taken over. And you can measure that. So that's exactly what we did. And by this line, you can see, hey, the vascular territories are taking over. This is all by the anastomosis I told you about. And you can repeat that experiment, etc. And you see that the connections, the numbers of anastomoses between the ACA, MCA, MCA, PCA, PCA, and ACA do differ, but in a way of variability. And that's exactly the point that I want to make. The diameters of these collaterals are very variable. And we know already also from this discussion that when you have a very, with the diameter of the PCOM is low, the diameter of the LMAs is higher. So it's kind of taking over the function of the circle of Willis, these PCOMs, collaterals. So we are talking about long-term adaptation also during life. And we know that it's there. It's nothing new. Like this is Moya Moya. We know this is a kind of a long-term adaptation of a slowly growing stenosis, proximal stenosis of the MCA or distal ICA. We know it's there. And that could also explain why it's so these vascular territories everybody talks about in this literature that it's very variable, because in the long term, just for some reasons, these vascular territories are changed and adaptate itself to a new situation. So these are collaterals that are natural and we already have in a very variable way. Now we talk about bypass surgery. It's nothing then surgical remodeling. It's nothing more or less than doing something about collaterals. Anyway, of course, it was the famous Yazaghil in 1967 who learned that for the first time that you could make this artificial bypass. You could make this artificial anastomosis. And maybe everybody knows it, but still I will go into detail. He started to do the STA-MCA bypass surgery in 1967. And he did a lot, and he learned us a lot. Also because he was doing so much anatomical research in the lab. That's why he dared to do that. And you see here an example of this, such an STA-MCA bypass. What is nothing more than an STA-MCA bypass is an occlusive technique. That means the recipient you want to stitch an anastomosis on, you make an anastomosis on, you have to temporarily occlude this recipient, like here. And then you will make this anastomosis by very small stitches. Sometimes it's 10-0 that you can use. And you can make a bypass in this ischemic period, and you make a connection between two vessels. That is exactly nothing more or less than bypass surgery. And you see it here more now in detail. Can you see it like here? Well, you see. Sometimes you see also that, like this is the donor, this is an STA or STA branch that has been stitched on the recipient, the MCA in this case. Sometimes you see in those books those very nice pictures of a very long part of the STA, very cleanly made. You should not do it. Don't touch the vessels more than is necessary. So just the distal end is to making open, making more clear the STA to make this anastomosis. Just a practical tip. And this is in stages how it's done. First, of course, you have to watch for the STA itself. Know that it is there before you start doing it. You can do a CTA or you can do Doppler on the outside. And then you have to prepare it. Find the STA. And you can use even ICG to confirm your work. Next step is opening the dura. When you're treating patients who already have their own bypasses, for instance, by the meningeal artery, don't touch the meningeal artery. It's because it is already an anastomosis. So then you would sacrifice an anastomosis that's already naturally there by making a new bypass. This is stupid. Just in between some trips and ticks, that's my opinion for you. Now, and then you open the dura and you find the recipient, like here. I cleared it only on the distal side a bit, so you can make the anastomosis. And I also do confirmation, of course, every time with a ICG that is absolutely necessary to have it, to confirm. Oh, you see also in the literature, we made a nice bypass and it was nicely pulsating. I can tell you, there are so many obstructed bypasses, they were nicely pulsating. So confirm the flow in this bypass, not by pulsations only. And then next time, then you have this STA bypass there. But we all know about this cost study. And again, a trial a surgical procedure by a trial. That is, of course, a good idea, but also not a good idea. But there's also a lot of discussions about this trial. But anyhow, the results, the conclusion was, you don't do an STA-MCA bypass, in generally spoken, in patients with a occluded ICA, internal carotid artery. That was the conclusion. So at that time, it was all abandoned. Bypass surgery should not do it. And neurosurgeons started to stop doing it, which is OK for a certain level. But you should never leave the complete technique out. Of course, we also have other techniques to make not only the STA MCA bypass itself, but also to make an end-to-end anastomosis, end-to-site anastomosis, and side-to-site anastomosis in specific cases. Just again, when you're a neurosurgeon, most of the complications are vascular. Maybe it's a bit too rough, but when you have complications, it's often vascular. So you know, have to know how to treat vascular vessels. So that's very important. So that's one part of the advantage of knowing how to treat vessels. Now in scheme, you see here that's the STA MCA bypass. General things, is it safe? Well, more or less. Is it easy? Well, more or less. It's occlusive. Is it fast? Well, more or less. Is it effective? Well, more or less. Is it minimal invasive? Well, more or less. So that's in generally spoken. One of the critics who could be that you have your bypass that is has too low flows. And now you're talking about something quantitative. Too low flow, it's not patent or not patent. No, the flow can be too low. And it is an ischemic technique. So and here comes the story from Professor Tulleke. He is my ancestor. He trained me to do neurosurgery. And he started an event that was about 25 years ago to invent the Elana technique. This is nothing than a non-occlusive anastomosis making. Just closely said, you have a vein, the VSM mostly. You have it on a platinum ring, very essential. You stitch it on, and then you stitch on the, for instance, the ICA here. And just all the blood is flowing, nothing happening. And then you use a special designed laser catheter that's circumferential with 160 laser tips in the ring. And then you go through, and you punch out the vessel part, and you have make an anastomosis. Non-occlusively. Okay. It's falling out of my, from my head. Okay. Now here you see it in this scheme again. So this vein is pinched on, and then you stitch this in the depth, for instance, on the ICA or the proximal MCA. And then you use the laser. It's coming in. Specially designed, handmade. And you apply vacuum for 1 minute before you just use the laser tips. And then you punch out a flap of the out of the wall, and you have make your anastomosis. Non-occlusively. By this, of course, this is only anastomosis, it's not a bypass, it's just anastomosis. This is the anastomosis. And then you can do everything you want with the rest of this vein. For instance, putting on somewhere else, another vessel, for making IC-IC bypass, or making an extracranial, intracranial high flow bypass. This is how it looks in the laboratory. This is on the left side, and this is how they do the punching. And on the right side, you see the flap taken out. And you see it in vivo. That's how it's done. You see the ring. You just look if that's not too big or too small, etc. And you pinch out this this vessel wall. And this is how it looks when you make an Elana high flow bypass, for instance, from the external carotid artery to the ICA, or on the left side again, external carotid artery to the ICA more proximally. This laser is not the light, you don't see it during surgery. This I just added it in so that you don't think that there will be this lightning there during surgery. So there's benefits of it, of course. No temporary occlusion, no ischemia, no hurry. You can, every step you can do, you have a drink in between. You can do, if you go to the toilet, and no hurries, no tension. And you can high flow bypasses. And you can do complete reconstructive surgery. So when you look at this, is it safe? Yes, it's safe. It's at least non-occlusive. Is it easy? No, it's not easy. You have to train that, not for just 1 year, just one course. That won't help you. You should do it so often. It's non-occlusive, that's the advantage. Is it fast? No, it takes something like 8-9 hours, that surgery. Is it effective? Can be very effective. Is minimal invasive? No, it's not minimal invasive. So that's one of the reasons that we thought, maybe should we make it more easy? So can we make a high flow, non-occlusive bypass without making the stitches? Because the stitches in the depth, that is the difficult part. So that's why we developed Celana. That means it's based on a clip. You see, that's a clip, but you have a ring on this, the same ring as you have in the Celana, and you use the same, as you have in the Elana, and you have the same catheter. Of course, this is not just invented on one night, and then the next day you'll try it. This is for 2-3 years of really research, again, in the lab. And the lab is so very essential to do this work, because you cannot just do it, again, not on a workshop for 1 week and then start doing it. And this is how it's in an animation. This is how it looks like. And I'll show you an example later on. This is the VSM, just like that. And you bring it in on the vessel, no stitches. You pinch it in, and you close the clip. And then you make go in with your laser anastomosis laser, and you make the anastomosis itself. This is something like 8 minutes. You can do that. So time is not that problem anymore. And I'll show you some cases later. For those who say, hey, listen, now you're putting some metal in a vessel, that could be a problem. Of course, we thought of that, about that. So we did all kinds of research also about the entelization of these clips inside the vessel. You see, there will be nice orifice, so as we call it. The Celana clip. So after 4 years, we did our trial, and we did the first patients. You see here now, this is the first patient we did. You see, you're pinching in. And then you close the clip, the bleeding starts immediately. Of course, this is not Elana for dummies. You really should train it. You check if it's in. And then you close the clip. And then you can, after that, you can burn and use the laser and make anastomosis. I will skip that now, but I showed you already previously. So that's how you can do it. And this is the result, how you can make a high flow bypass, if needed, of course. So we have now 3 types of bypass types, conventional Elana, Celana, and all with these advantages of itself. And now one of the things is that we also make, we think, well, maybe it could be something, because if these aneurysms we get are now much more getting complicated, we're also thinking of developing a micro Celana clip with vessels up to 1.8 to 2.5 millimeters. But maybe you can think, well, you can do that easily, occlusively, just conventionally. Could be, but in some cases, that could be difficult. But that's a discussion. But we have more opportunities. That's the essential. Now, before you think, oh, I'm a clever boy, I can do that. I can do a bypass, I did my training, and I have my muscles now, and I think, I'm ready for it. And I think you will confirm it, because I heard you talk about the AVMs. It's not the technical thing. It's the making of decisions. It's the whole procedure. It's not nothing like, hey, I can train my stitching and I can do bypasses. No, it has to do with much more than that. And that makes it much more difficult. I always say you can learn a monkey to do tricks. Making bypass, that's not a problem. We can all learn it, but the point is, you have to learn, what's your experience? What will you do when you have a high flow there or a low flow there? What are the complications? Because that's what we're dealing with. And especially these are the patients now. We're getting more and more very complex aneurysms. Having bled or not having bled, growing, giving symptoms, and I'll show you some later on. Of course, generally spoken, giant aneurysms, of course, we can do proximal occlusion. Do your BTO and trust on the leptomeningeals? Of course, if you can do that, perfect. Don't do any complicated surgeries. You can do reconstructive clipping, of course, after having decided not to do it endovascularly. Of course, that's how in our team also. Very important that we are as a group and decide, well, that will be clipped, that will be coiled, that will be even used with diverters, but that is not impossible. That patient by one of these items, and then we have to do a flow replacement bypass surgery. But these are, again, very specialized cases. And again, it's not a technical thing, it's the whole thinking about it. Because then you say, okay, what kind of bypass do we need? Is it STA, MCA, ACA, MCA? Occipital pica, call it. And then you have to decide, is there a low flow, medium flow, or a high flow bypass needed? And then you have to know about the collaterals of this patient. So one of the most important things, and that you don't hear that too often, are the flow measurements. You can do them preoperative, intraoperative, and postoperative. You can do them. It's much more than having a nice signal on your ICG. ICG says nothing, only patency, but nothing about flow. More about velocity or something. So there's much more you have to know. Low flow, high flow, you have to know what kind of type of bypass, and you have to consider, is there a flow replacement or a flow measure? Do you do a flow replacement or a flow augmentation? And you have to take the balance between risk and efficiency before you even make one decision to do surgery. Preoperative measurements also with the NOVA technique. We now starting that in Utrecht having as well, that you can have seen, you can have an insight on all the flows intracranially of this specific patient. And intraoperatively, we have to do flow measurements. That has to do with the flow meter. And postoperatively, again, you can do MRI, MRF, and NOVA techniques. Again, intraoperatively, Doppler says nothing about flow. It says something about velocity. ICG, maybe something about velocity. It says something about patency, nothing about flow. Even not the flow seismometer, new microscope, it's called flow. It says nothing about flow. It says something about velocity. And you have to know about flow, because you want to know what you're doing. And you have to be sure, as much as possible, that you're safe what you're doing, when you're doing these complicated things, of course. Again, consider what you have in your hands and look at the risks that you are taking or not taking. So it's custom made, and you should do a quantification of the flow that's needed, and you have to make an estimation of the risk of the technique. And again, I'm coming up to a discussion that's where we can have that also later on. Doing a conventional technique on a proximal high flow vessel, there are heroes that can do it. Of course, everybody can do it, but you take more risk if you don't know about the collaterals of that patient. And if you can do a anastomosis handily done within 5 minutes, perfect. You don't need any complicated materials, but you're taking more risks the more proximal you get. And this is just an example of that. So if you're getting more high, more proximal, you're taking high flows, and you go into that, and then make the decision, maybe shoot non-occlusively, if needed. Or otherwise, do brain protection, cardiac arrest even. I don't have experience with that. You need a high skill, again, stressful, and you have a limited time frame. So we think that in that case, Elana or Celana is a solution. So again, balance between risk and efficiency. And of course, flow augmentation and replacement are very important factors in this. So now I'm going to do this patient selection. That is very, very important. Again, it's the risk, the balance between the risk, of your technique, balance between what you need, and balance between leptomeningeal anastomosis, which are in this patient, maybe yes or no. So microsurgery, that's something that Jessica told us, is not merely the occasional use of the operation microscope. That's very true. My statement is also, bypass surgery is not merely making anastomosis, but a complex cascade of choices in order to obtain flow. And after creating a replacement bypass for giant aneurysm, surgery only begins. And I give you now a few cases, example of cases. Female, 24 years, only having headache. Okay, your suggestions, please. Endovascular? I want to